Hello there everybody, Sam's Trains here, welcome back to the railway. Now, portions of this video are going to be shown to you in 3D. Ooh, pretty cool. So if you've got any of these 3D glasses lying around, if you know where they are, it might be worth going to get them. Now, if you haven't got any of these, that doesn't matter at all. As I say, it's only going to be a tiny portion of this video that is going to be shown in 3D. However, if you are interested and you'd like to experience it, I mean, I'm not sure whether it's going to work or not at this point, but if you'd like to experience it, I will include a link in the description so that you can pick yourself some of these up. Hopefully they won't be too expensive. If they are, I apologise, but they shouldn't be too expensive. So, if you saw my April Fool's Day stream, slash prank, slash ludicrousy, you might remember a portion of that where I did a bit of a parody, if you like, on a video from BRM parodying their 3D magazine supplement. Now, you might not have realised it was a parody because the original video hasn't had very many views. At the time of filming this, it's only had 700-800 views or something like that. So, if you'd like to check it out, I've included another link in the description. That'll be the second one down. It's sort of a crazy video. It's ridiculously contrived, it's beautifully over the top, and also very well made, so it's certainly worth checking it out. But that did get me thinking about 3D. I thought, thrown them across the room. I've got the 3D glasses now, so why not give it a try? Now, as you might have been able to tell from my April Fool's video, I don't particularly like 3D, whether it's anaglyph, 3D like this, which uses the red or blue, or whether it's proper 3D where you have the polarized filters on your eyes instead of the color filters, that's a little bit more effective. But either way, I'm not too keen on it. For some reason, whenever I've watched a movie in 3D or looked at photos in 3D, my brain seems to realize that it's just an illusion and I end up with a headache, or sometimes if there's a lot of motion in the film, I end up with nausea or something like that. So I don't like it particularly, but nobody can deny that it is pretty cool, and I wanted to maybe give it a try with my models and see if I can take some 3D photos. So I'm a filmmaker by trade, so I do have a little bit of an idea of how these things work and how 3D works. I've never tried it before, so I can't say for sure that I know how it works, but we'll find out later on. However, thinking about it, to photograph models in a different scale to normal, must be a different kettle of fish. There must be something different there. So I was wondering how we would go about doing this. So I did have a quick look at the British Railway Modelling YouTube channel to see if there were any answers on how models were photographed. And I did. I actually found a video which was an interview with the photographer of the 3D stuff. His name was Paul, I think. And I'll show you a little insert from that interview right now.
You also need to have a selection of shots from which to produce the 3D image. So I don't just take images from two perspectives, I take them from about five.
So if there are any, photographers, anybody that does filmmaking or knows anything about 3D imagery, you might be trying to hold it together a bit now. So the idea I got from that was that you take lots of different photos five different photos from different angles and somehow mix them together or choose different pairs and put them together to make a 3D image. Now, to me, that doesn't sound like a very exact science. It sounds like a little bit of trial and error, if you ask me. And my experience of 3D in the past has been quite the opposite of that. It is quite an exact science as far as I understand it, so that didn't make a lot of sense to me. Now, there are two possible reasons why that might not make a lot of sense to me. The first and most likely reason is that Paul knows an awful lot more about this than I do. That's definitely feasible. As I say, I've never done it before. And so if that's true, that will become painfully apparent when I try this, and I'm going to try in a moment or two. The second possible reason is it wouldn't make sense for him to sit there in that interview and say, yeah, it's dead easy. You just take two photos and stack them on top of each other, change the channels a little bit, and Bob's your uncle. Because obviously they're trying to sell this as a supplement, as part of their magazine. So they want to, well, it would make sense for them to want to frame it as complicated, as difficult, as modern and cool as possible. And so I completely understand that. And of course, there's this idea of exclusivity as well. If people just go away and try it themselves, that takes away from the product that they're trying to sell, if you like. So it makes sense that they don't want to frame it as something too simple, for example. But I think it is quite simple, and we're going to find that out. So let's talk a little bit about how this works then. Now, as I said earlier, the red blue 3D is known as anaglyph 3D, and this is actually a very, very old technology. It was first, I think the first photo was taken in this form of 3D in the mid 1800s, so that's a very, very long time ago. The first film to be shot in 3D was from 1922, I think. If any film buffs are out there, let me know in the comments what film that was and you get a gold star. So it's certainly nothing new, but basically how it works is two images in a photo. We won't talk about film right now, we'll talk about in a photo. So in a photo, two separate images are photographed, basically, and the images are a slight distance apart. Now, to photograph real-life objects, so in the scale of 1:1, the camera needs to move sort of the distance between the eyes. So what's that, a few centimetres perhaps? Sorry, I didn't mean to make that signal at the camera. So a few centimetres apart, and then obviously you need a way when you're feeding back the photo, when you're looking at the photo, you need a way to distinguish those two photos. So you put the filters over the eyes. This eye only sees red and this eye sees the rest. This is the blue, so that's opposite to red, so you get to see the other filter. When you put that on your eyes, this eye sees red, this eye sees blue. And then on the image, you separate the two images in terms of channel so that your left eye sees the red image and the right eye sees the rest of the colours. Now, as I say, that's not the most effective way to do 3D. More recently, the idea of polarised 3D has been introduced, and that is slightly different. You still have two photos taken per 3D image. However, they are polarized, and I won't go into image polarization too much here, but if you want to find that out, you can look it up. But basically that means that you can put polarized filters over your eyes, which separate the images, but it doesn't do it with color, it does it with the actual waveform of the light. So you lose a little bit of intensity, which is why when you take your 3D glasses off in the cinema watching a 3D movie, the image is noticeably brighter, and that's because the polarizing filters do bring the brightness down. But they're better because you can see a full range of color, you don't end up with one red eye and one blue eye and seeing the world as though you were a Martian or something. But that only works on sort of screen media where you can polarize the light that's coming to hit your eyes. So 3D TVs can do it, some phones can do it, they can do it in the cinema because they use two separate projectors. But on print media, as BRM we're using, and on your normal monitors, there's no way to do that unless, of course, you've got a special monitor. So we're going to have to stick with the anaglyph 3D, which is unfortunate, but I think we can work with it. So, as I've been saying, in order to take a normal 3D photo of a scale of 1:1 object, you need to space the camera about the distance between the eyes. But obviously, if we did that with 00 gauge or any sort of scale, the photos would come out as though you were a giant. If you think about it, the spacing between small objects like that would be gigantic, and then things would pop out of the screen. And generally speaking, the bigger the distance between objects in the two photos you take, the more it's going to pop out into your face. And in fact, if we take a look at this particular image from BRM, you can see a little bit of this. So you can see, if we look at the chimney, for example, on this pannier tank, you can see that the two channels are quite a big distance apart. Now, that will pop out at you, and if you've got 3D glasses on, try it and see if it does. And then if you look a little bit further back towards the photo, about halfway through the coach, you can see that the two images have basically converged there, and so that won't be 3D at all, that will just look completely normal if you look at that with 3D glasses. And then if we look at some objects a little bit further away from the camera in this shot, you can see that the two channels are diverging again, they're going away from each other, and I don't know why that is. Either way, when you put your 3D glasses on to look at this image here, it really doesn't work. My particular eyes can't focus on this at all, it just fails completely. Although it looks as though this is the front cover, doesn't it, from the Pendon Museum in 3D booklet. So I wonder whether this has just been fabricated to look like a 3D image, even though it's not. But either way, we're only looking at it here in low resolution. The real thing presumably will be much higher quality. So it's perhaps unfair to judge it right now, but to me, that doesn't look like, well, it doesn't look like a proper 3D photo. And when I put my 3D glasses on to look at it, it hurts the eyes, to say the least. It doesn't work all that well. It's certainly quite odd looking. So we'll try and fix that. So that's the thing. So you don't want to be spacing the camera the distance of the eyes apart because you're in 00 gauge. So you want the spacing of the camera to be that of a 00 gauge person. Now that is where things get crazy. Okay. Here's a 00 gauge man, and as you can see, you can't even see his eyes, he's that tiny. But the spacing between his eyes is absolutely infinitesimal, it's about a millimetre. So I'm going to try that. The first photo I take is going to be, the first two photos I take are going to be where the camera is spaced about a millimetre apart. Now, even though the science makes sense behind that, I can't imagine that that is going to make much of an eye-popping effect. Now, clearly we're photographing model railways here. We don't want the effect to be in your face and bursting out of the screen, because then you'll have a reaction like this. And of course, that's not what you want. So we want this to be a little bit subtle, but I don't know whether this is going to be too subtle. So we'll make this a bit of an experiment. So I will do one with a very fractional movement between the two photos. Then I'll do one, well, I'll double it. So I'll try about about 4 millimeter spacing. We'll see how that works. Then we'll go a little bit more. We'll go a bit crazy and try a centimeter or something like that. Still less than the distance between the human eyes though. And we will see. Now, if you get too far, things are going to start popping out of the screen, but if you go even further than that, your eyes won't be able to focus on them. The two points of the 3D object will be too far apart and you won't be able to focus on them. So we'll see what happens. It should be interesting. Now obviously we're not photographing my railway here in order to make beautiful imagery. This is just purely a test of concept. But if you've got a nice layout, unlike me, do give it a try and let me know and see if it works for you. So, a little bit of an experiment. Let's try this and see if we can create some pleasant 3D imagery on the eyes that doesn't burst out of the screen too much and just looks a little realistic. Don't want to frighten anybody with this. Okay, so here is the setup. I have set up a very, very simple situation. Now, as Paul rightly said in the interview, and by the way, I don't know if I've already said this, but I will include a link in the description. It is important to have something in the foreground. So here's what I've got. I've got a little bit of fence, a little bit of bushes here. In the less immediate foreground, we have a terrier here. And then over in the background, I have the LBSC E4 right in the background there. When I actually take the photos, I'm going to shut the iris right down to try and get as deep a depth of field as possible. I'm not really using an ideal lens for this. I have got another lens, so I might try a different lens later on. But for the time being, we will press on with this. Now, for the second photo, I'm going to move the camera about 2 millimeters, which is a little bit more. But of course, you have to remember that if this camera here was a 00 gauge camera, I'd be able to focus in a lot closer to locomotives and things than I am able to here. This is about the distance the Terrier here is about as close as it can get to the camera and still able to be focused upon. So I'm accounting for that by zooming in very slightly. And so therefore I am going to move it a little bit more. So it might not look very natural. It might look a little bit too eye-popping, but we will try it. So I'm going to move the camera now approximately 2 millimeters, which is not very far. It's that. That's the distance. So that's what the second photo is going to look like. I can't take them while I'm recording, but I will take them in just a second. Then for the next photo, I'm going to move it another 2 millimeters. So let's do that. There we go, it'll look like that. And then for the final photo, I'm going to move about 6 millimeters further, which should look like that. And that should really pop out, or possibly we won't even be able to focus on that. So I'm going to take these photos and then we're going to process them. Okay, so the photos are now processed. I'm not going to go deep into the actual process of, turning them into 3D photos, because every editing software is different. But basically all you do is you lay the two photos that you want to merge on top of each other. You make sure that the leftmost image is on the top, and you just change the blending options for that top image so that it's only showing the red channel. And that's all you do. So if you want to know how to do that with your photo editing software of choice, just look it up online and there should be a tutorial for that for you. But for now, let's review some of these photos. Get your 3D glasses if you've got them, and we will see how they look. Okay, folks, it is the moment of truth. If you've got 3D glasses with you, this is when you're going to need them, because I'm going to gaze at my creations for the first time with 3D glasses on my iPad here. Now, I'm going to start off with the final photo I took, so the 1 centimeter, 10 millimeter separation mixed together with the first photo I took. So that should be the worst by my reckoning, and then we're going to go progressively back and to the first one I took, which I hope will be the best. So if you've got 3D glasses, let's pop them on now. Ah! No, not really. If you have that reaction, I've done it wrong completely, because it's supposed to look natural and not as though I've just created a portal and looked into another dimension. Okay, are you ready then? So first look. Right, so with the 10 millimeter separation, that looks very dreadful. In fact, my eyes are struggling to focus on that. Yeah, not working, That's a fail. So, as expected, that didn't work very well. So now I'm going to switch to the, what was it now, 4mm separation. By the way, let me know in the comments which one of these you like the best as well. Okay, I'm gonna look. You ready? Okay, so my eyes can focus on it. Move my head side to side. That's something you should do, by the way, because that gives it a bit of perspective. Bits of it look good. The hedge here in the foreground looks quite good. And that static grass on the right-hand side looks all right. The E4 in the background looks very good. That looks very 3D. But the Terrier looks a little bit, I don't know, there's something wrong. I can sort of see the smoke box dart through both eyes at different positions, if that makes sense. So it's good, it's a lot better than the first, but it's not fantastic. So I'm hoping that the 2mm separation version is gonna be the best. So let's look on this one. Ah, there we go. So it's, the 3D is a lot less pronounced on that one. It is more subtle. I would go as far as to say it's a bit more realistic. Which you prefer, I don't know. I think the 4mm separation is a lot more eye-popping. It's a lot more obvious. This is more subtle, but I would probably go as far as to say more realistic. And I can turn my iPad right at some crazy angles and get to see it. But yeah, no violent reactions to any of these, which is good. So that's a success. I think my favorite is the first one, the smallest separation. So I think what we'll do is in future, depending on the situation, the ideal separation seems to be somewhere between 2 and 4mm, so maybe 3mm. But of course, if you zoom in, that's going to change things. And by the way, I did change lens to a much smaller lens and zoomed out all of the way. So the photos that you've just seen were not zoomed in any way. But this is a video channel. We don't want to stop at photographs, do we? We want to try and do some 3D video. Now, I really have no idea how I'm going to do this on the processing side, but we'll try and find a way. Now, this is going to be difficult because normally when you're photographing real life objects in 3D, you can get special cameras which have two lenses a certain distance apart and you can film like that. But we can't do that in model form because there's no way to get the two lenses that close together. I don't think there's any lens tiny enough. So what we've got to do is recreate the same situation twice. So I'm going to run the Terrier past the camera, basically twice. I'm going to start it in the same position. I'm going to try and get the rods in the same position so that the wheels hopefully come out right as well. If not, there'll just be a little bit of confusion there when you look at the wheels. But you have to do this in a situation where you can control all of the movement. So for example, my wind turbine can't be in the shot, I can't be moving in the shot. Everything has to be exactly the same in the two shots, apart from the movement, and of course the movement has to be the same as well. So I don't know whether it's going to work, but I think it's certainly worth a try, isn't it? So, I'm just thinking how I'm going to do it. Right, well we'll try it, let's see what happens. So, the first job is to try and create a shot where the Terrier will stay in focus as it passes the camera, but also it needs to get slightly closer to the camera as it does so, as it passes. So here it should be a little further away, and then here it should get a little closer. So in fact, what I might do is angle the camera around a little bit to try and amplify that approach a little bit. And I'm just setting up my ruler behind. Okay, so let's just pop the Terrier in the middle of the shot to start with and get focused in on that. Obviously, it's out of focus at the moment. And yes, it seems as though I can get it in focus. Now, if I take it towards the end of the shot, that drifts a little bit, but it's not too bad. I've got the iris set to f16, so that's quite... It can close a little bit further, but then we lose a bit of light, so it's a compromise, really. That's a little bit out of focus there, but I don't think it's going to look too bad. So, let's give this a try then. So what I've done is I've set the Terrier so that the rods on this side, on our side, which is the right-hand side, have got, well, they're right at the bottom, as you can see. And I've also got a starting point. So the Terrier I'm going to place at a certain starting point, very specifically, and then I'm going to give the controller power. I'm not going to speed it up slowly because that will change the synchronization. I'm just going to give it power at a slow speed and film it going by. So let's try that, and then I need to repeat it, obviously. So, I'm setting this up at the starting point now, and I'm trying to get it as accurate as possible. I think the wheels are going to get out of sync. That's my prediction. I'm starting her as close to the scene as I can without it actually being in shot. So the likelihood of it getting out of sync should be reduced, but I think it's still going to happen. Okay, power. It is nice and slow because I don't want any wheel slip. And we're going for realism here, or as much as we can on a layout that looks like mine. So there it goes. Should be coming into shot now. Is that right? Yes. Okay, so that's done. Now what I need to do is I'm not going to touch the speed. I'm just going to take the Terrier straight off the track. You can't see this and I can't show you because if I move the camera it spoils everything. So now what I'm going to do is on a separate track, I'll just narrate what I'm doing so that you can tell. I'm just going to get the Terrier to crawl forwards again so that the coupling rod is down at the bottom as it was. There we go. And now I'm going to cut the power to my controllers. Like that, so the controllers are off. I'm now taking the Terrier back to the starting point where I'm going to line it up to exactly where I put it to start with. And now, of course, the most important factor to change is going to be the position of the camera. And based on my test results from last time, I need to move it approximately 3 millimeters. So I'm going to do that. Okay. So that's 1, 2, 3. So that should be optimum. Whether it actually will be or not, I'm not sure. But for now, let's try it. Hey, I'm nervous. I don't know whether this is going to work. It's an awful lot of effort. And as soon as you start adding rolling stock, it's going to be increasingly difficult. But let's give it power. If you add rolling stock, of course, then you end up with wheel slip and couplings moving in different ways and all sorts of different stuff going on. So I'm doing this as simply as possible, just as a proof of concept. And then if people want to complicate it further, you absolutely can do. Right, it is done. It is done, folks. So I'm going to go now into my video editing software, and as I say, I don't know whether it's possible to do this or not. I'm sure it is, but whether or not I discover a way to do it, I don't know. But I'm going to go and try it now, and I'll meet you back up here in just a second. Okay then, folks, it is the moment of truth. I've been able to edit it together. Now, so far, I've only watched it without the 3D glasses on, and unfortunately, despite my efforts to try and synchronize the coupling rods on the logo, it hasn't worked. Now, I don't know why it hasn't worked, because I was very stringent. I didn't touch the controllers at all between the tests. I just literally powered it on. So I don't know exactly why they came out of sync, and if you actually look at it in a second without the 3D glasses, you can see that they're just slightly out of phase, the two shots. So they're in sync for 1 second, and then a few rotations later they're out of sync, and then so on and so forth. So they're very close but just not exactly the same. I don't know why that would be. Maybe there's a slight dirt buildup in the track between the two shots. Perhaps the motors had chance to warm up. I think it's just too many different factors that affect it. However, the motion is relatively okay, and what I think I might do is try editing it again and try time stretching one of the layers to try and actually synchronize them to see if that improves things. But moment of truth. 3D glasses on. Let's see if this works. I don't know whether it will or not. Okay. Play. All right. Cool. So, I don't know, you guys will have to let me know what happened there. So when the low coat was in the center of the frame or thereabouts, it looked fine. However, when it was out the left side of the frame or on the right side, at the very far side, it seemed to lose the effect a little bit. So I don't really know why that is. I suppose once again it has to do with photographing in model form. There's no problem photographing stills in that way, by the way. It just seems to be something to do with the motion. Now, another thing that it does demonstrate is earlier on that I was actually wrong. So if we look at an early frame here, you can see that the chimney is quite a bit blurred there, as you can see. And then as we play through, if we stop it somewhere in the middle, you can see that it focuses, it converges completely. And then as it goes across to the right-hand side of the screen, it opens out again. And that's exactly what we saw on this BRM image. And so I apologize for what I said earlier. It does seem as though that is a real phenomenon. I thought I understood that, but obviously not. So I'm going to go and re-edit this. I'm going to see if I can change it. At the moment, I don't think that's going to work. I think it's just going to cause more issues, but I want to see if I can just slightly time stretch one of the layers and see if we can get them to synchronize a little bit better. It will certainly be interesting. Okay, so this is getting very, very interesting now. So basically what I've done is, in the center of the clip where the loco is easy to see and it's easy to see what the wheels are doing, on the first clip I filmed, I've taken 2 points. So the wheel, the front wheel, at point A is in a certain position and at point B it's in a different position, then what I've done is I've looked at the second layer and got those same points on that clip. I hope this makes sense. And then I've changed the speed of the clip so that those two points match on both clips. And having done that, it now seems that the coupling rods are now perfectly in sync. Not 100% perfectly, but more or less. So that does demonstrate that in fact they do run at an exactly constant speed, close enough. It really was just a different speed between the two takes, which is really, really weird. Now, it has done something really quite strange. Basically, because one of the clips has been slowed down, there is a little bit of frame skipping. Now, you wouldn't normally be able to notice that, but because the two clips are playing side by side, you can see when one of the frames gets skipped. If that doesn't make sense to you, don't worry about it. But let's see how this looks. I don't expect it will look any more realistic, but I hope that the at least the coupling rods on this shot will look better. So let's try. Here it comes now. Wow. Actually, I'm completely wrong there. That has fixed the problem. Let's watch that again. Let's put these glasses back on. That looks now like I'm just looking at the thing working normally, and the frame skipping isn't apparent at all. It is when you take your glasses off. Wow, that's great. It's still a bit out of focus when it comes into the shot. Wow, that's cool. One more time. So it does work. It's a lot more effort than it's worth. Wow. That is very cool. Well, there's a little bit of science for you, I suppose. It does work. 3D photography is very easy, and if you fancy trying it, I would do. It was quite fun, and as I say, quite easy to do. The 3D video is a lot of fun, but of course it does take a lot more precision and a bit more technical know-how on the editing side. But either way, that was fascinating, and I'm quite pleased that I was able to get at least some sort of rudimentary 3D to work on video. I never thought I'd be able to do it. I didn't think it would work, but it had to be done, and it was done, and it seemed to work quite well. As I say, I prefer just to watch in 2D, so you're not going to get running sessions from me in 3D because it would take hours and hours and hours, and I don't think it would be effective anyway, but it does work. And so there we go, that answers the question, can you film in 3D? Yes. Is it worth the effort? Probably not. But it can be made to look effective with a bit of effort. So, very, very interesting. So I hope you enjoyed that. Let me know if you've got 3D glasses. Oops, nearly hit myself in the face. If you've got them, did it work for you on your screen? Is it just my iPad that makes it work? If you've got a big TV screen, does it work on that? Let me know. It would be very interesting to hear from you. So, thank you very much for watching. Man, I enjoyed that. I thought this would be a dull video. Maybe it was. Maybe it was from your end, but I've really enjoyed doing that. I'm going to go and experiment again, I think. But I won't show you anymore because this has gone on for long enough. So thank you for watching, and I will see you very soon. All right, there we go. There's another look at it. Absolutely fantastic. I loved that. That was fun. All right, see you soon, folks.